The bony pelvis consists of the two hip bones and the sacrum and the coccyx. The two hip bones articulate anteriorly at the symphysis pubis, which is a secondary cartilaginous joint, and the hip bone articulate with the sacrum by the sacroiliac joint, which is a synovial joint of the plane variety. The sacrum, which consists of five fused sacral segments, articulates with the coccyx. This is the coccyx here at the sacrococcygeal joint. There is a lot of mobility at this joint between the sacrum and coccyx. In the anatomical position of the pelvis, the anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic symphysis, they lie in the same vertical plane. The hip bone consists of the ilium, the pubis, and the ischium. This piece of bone between the symphysis pubis and the pubic tubercle is called the pubic crest. Lateral to the pubic tubercle and constituting part of the superior ramus of the pubis, because the pubis actually consists of a body, superior ramus, and inferior ramus. So on the superior ramus of the pubis, there is a line here, which is called the pectineal line. The pectineal line continues up or back to the iliopubic eminence. This eminence of bone is located between the ilium and the pubis, so it is called the iliopubic eminence. Then, this pectineal line continues as the arcuate line of the ilium. Arcuate line of the ilium. The arcuate line of the ilium, the pectineal line of the pubis, and the pubic crest, they constitute what is called the linea terminalis. Now, if we follow posteriorly, there will be the ala of the sacrum, and then the prominent part of the first piece of the sacrum, which is called the promontory of the sacrum. Together, all these bony landmarks and lines, they constitute the boundary of the superior pelvic aperture, or the pelvic inlet. The superior pelvic aperture, as you can see here, in the anatomical position of the pelvis, is angulated. There is an angle between it and the horizontal plane. This angle is about 50 to 60 degrees with the horizontal. Inferiorly is the inferior pelvic aperture. And the inferior pelvic aperture is bounded by the lower border of the symphysis pubis, by the ischiopubic ramus, because the ischium has an ischial tuberosity and an ischial ramus. The ischial ramus with the inferior pubic ramus constitute what is called the ischiopubic ramus. So going back, this is the lower border of the symphysis pubis, the ischiopubic ramus, the ischial tuberosity. And from the ischial tuberosity, you can see that the posterior border of the bone is irregular, but this does not constitute the boundary of the pelvic outlet. The pelvic outlet is bounded posteriorly by a very strong ligament that extends between the ischial tuberosity and the sacrum, and this is called the sacrotuberous ligament. Posteriorly, the posterior boundary is the tip of the coccyx. But from the practical point of view, because of the great mobility of the coccyx, then dimensions are taken to the tip of the sacrum. If we look at the pelvic outlet from the side, we will see that the pelvic outlet is not in a single plane, unlike the pelvic inlet. The pelvic inlet is in a single plane, and this plane makes an angle of 50 to 60 degrees with the horizontal. But the outlet is not in a single plane. It is in two planes. This is a plastinated specimen showing some of the ligaments. If we look at the ligaments posteriorly, we can see here that there are two ligaments. One of them extends between the ischial spine and the sacrum, so it is the sacrospinous ligament, and the other extends between the sacrum and the ischial tuberosity, so it is called the sacrotuberous ligament. This sacrotuberous ligament, here again, this is the sacrotuberous ligament, together with the, its counterpart on the other side, they bound the outlet of the pelvis. So you can see that the shape of the outlet of the pelvis will become diamond in shape, bounded by the lower border of the symphysis pubis anteriorly, posteriorly by the tip of the coccyx, and on the sides, there are the two ischial tuberosities here.